Well, hello there, all you amazing people. We are now going to talk about why you all are so misunderstanding how macOS is using and handling RAM. And all or almost most of the criticism that you have about 8 gigabyte is not enough and 16 gigabyte is barely enough, 2000 gigabytes is the bare minimum, is wrong. This is how iStat menu, the good old tool that most Mac users use, explains what memory is, or how memory's information is being displayed. Wired memory. This is memory that applications or this system needs immediately access to, so it can be cached on the disk. It will depend on what application using it. Active memory. This is memory that is actively being used. Inactive memory. Memory is no longer being used and has been cached to the disk that remains in RAM until application needs that space. Free memory. Memory is not being used, so the squatter got kicked out of the house. App memory. Memory used by apps and their processes. Compressed memory. Memory that is being compressed to make more space available to other processes. Memory is compressed to limit swap disk. Let's look at how Apple is defining it here. They also go into memory pressure. Memory pressure graphically represent how efficiently your memory is saving your processes need. This is why, you know, memory pressure, in my opinion, is the best indicator if you need more or less RAM. Again, memory pressure is determined by the amount of free memory swap rate, wired memory, and free cache memory. If you have a really, really high memory pressure, in my humble opinion, I would say 80 plus, that is where you need to think about, I may need more memory. I may need a RAM upgrade. Anything below that, I'm recording right now and I have a memory pressure with about 25 apps, tabs running at the same time, an OBS, Spotify, a VPN, Discord, Mail, Safari, Chrome running, and I'm doing this shit here, and my memory press is 56%. So it's, and on idle, let me put it this way, on idle, you may hover around with a few programs open, you'll be around the 40s mark. If you're just booting up and doing nothing, you may be in the 30, under 30. But between 30 and 40 is kind of like when you are doing limited work. So I'm barely using or stressing out my memory. 8 gigs of RAM, people. Physical memory, the amount of RAM installed, of course. Memory used, the amount of memory being used to the right, you can see how the memory is allocated as, you know, we look at the activity monitor. App memory, the amount of memory being used by apps. Wired memory, memory required by the system to operate. This memory can be cached and must be in RAM. Can be cached, must be in RAM. So it's not available to other apps. Compressed memory, it's basically the same thing. Cached memory, swap users here, the amount of space being used on your system's disk to swap unused files to and from memory. So it's kind of like a little bit of, okay, we don't need this right now. There's an open program that may or have to access it when you're actively using it and stuff like that. Let's put that into to swap memory. And then it will go back and forth. There is something I forget to look into. So let's look at a lifespan. How long does a SSD last? Because a lot of people say, oh, well, rewriting to your SSD is going to be, you know, really bad. The age of an SSD determines its performance and longevity. Even if manufacturers claim that they can last for 10 years, the average lifespan of an SSD is less than 10 years. Above all, it depends on the users. And there's a lot of articles here it make use of. They have one here. You can go in and look at how they are looking at it. It has something to do with read-write. Does it have garbage collection? Blah, blah, blah. How big are the files you're writing to? Sectors and cycles and blah, blah, blah. And all that fucking shit. The thing here is, on a modern SSD with normal use, not massively taxing out the system, having 10,000 apps open that is heavily memory depending and stuff like that, on average use, you will get about 10 years of your SSD, about. I have an SSD that's over 10 years old, and when I do smart scans on and stuff like that, that's perfect. That's my old Windows install that I used on systems with 4 gigs of RAM, 8 gigs of RAM, 16 gigs of RAM, and 32 gigs of RAM. And even with 32 gigs of RAM, Windows still used the page file. Okay, which is basically caching, what they call caching on the Mac OS. It's actually paging. Oh, yep, the page file. People are not understanding what they are talking about when they talk about this. I'm not saying you can't ruin your SSD. Of course you can. But you have to almost try to do it. And here's another thing. Not a lot of people are running their computers for 10 years. Most people, the average upgrade cycle, or a lot of people, they upgrade before 10 years. Most people get fucking anxious in their pansies if their system is 2 or 3 years old. You know, if it's 5 years old, they're about to run screaming out of the house in fear of it blowing up in their face. People upgrade sooner than you think. Not all. Again, if you're one of those like me that keeps your system running until they're dying almost, I get you, Bobby. I get you. But all of this is because people have heard about degradation, they heard about SSD's lifespan, and then they don't really look into what's happening. They just read an article about, oh my god, your SSD dies faster with read-write, therefore you should not do massive read-write cycles to it. And they don't understand what that really means. And then they're looking at systems that have 8 gig or less memory, and they're looking at cache. Here's the thing. I have a 32 gig Windows machine. It still uses the page file or caching. I have used 100 plus gigabyte Windows systems and Linux systems. If the Linux system have a swap partition, which is a page partition, or a swap file, which is a page file, it still caches memory. It just don't caches that much. So the more RAM you have, the less cache is being used, but you are still caching, paging. It don't matter that much how much RAM you have, depending on if your system is caching or not. What it do mean is that how much are in the cache file. So how big is it? How much memory space does it take? It could also depend on, you know, how active is the cache file or the page file, which could help a little bit with cycling, of course, recycling, but not much. The only way you can save your hard drive from the paging hell of doom and stuff like that is to go the Linux way and just having no swap file or no swap partition, living in RAM. But then you hear all the Linux nerds say, oh, well, you need a cache partition or swap partition, because then your system won't run and blah, blah, blah. And here's a kicker. That's true if you want to hibernate. So if you are angry at us Mac users for running a system that uses a swap file, a page file, and here's the thing, it's not, Mac OS don't swap, Windows don't swap, Linux don't swap. They all page. Swap is just a normal terminology that most people understand, so therefore they use it. Linux, if you look up the current documentation, they say it's not swapping, it's paging. Windows is saying the same, Mac OS is saying the same, but most people, just for generalization, because it's a little bit easier to understand, they use the word swapping. Okay, so you are angry at me and everyone else for using a lot of swapping or paging, and then you are having your Windows or Linux machine to do the exact same thing if you are having a swap partition, and if you're having a laptop or swap file. And sometimes even if you don't use a laptop, but you have a page file or swap file. That's highly hypocritical. Can you see this right now? I don't think you can. You can barely see it. Yeah, you can see my swap memory use. I use about 2.18 gigabytes of swap memory right now. And you can see paging in and out. It's barely using any read-write cycle. Oh, well, now it's up to 8.7 kilobit or byte or whatever the fuck it is, I can't remember right now. Your hard drive is almost never 100% idle. You will have programs writing to config files. You will have programs writing to some other fucking shit. You will have program caching, you know, caching to cookies, caching to cache directories and stuff like that. This has become so big of an issue for so many people that don't know what they're talking about, because they are listening into other people that don't know what they're talking about. Go look at your Linux machine, Windows machine right now. Just watching this fucking video, you have disk activity. Why is that not bad then? But it's only bad when you have disk activity with a swap file or page file. You see how stupid this is. Right now I'm doing nothing and talking to you guys, and you can see the page in and out right now. I bet you would have about the same, if even not more, disk activity. Can I see my disk activity here? You guys can't see that. You can see some of it. But I can kind of tell you right now that, of course, OBS Studio, if you disregard that, I have about 300 to 1 megabyte on average random read writes all over my system. Just doing nothing. Spotify just have a 32 kilobit or byte or whatever it's called. You know, you can see here stuff is happening. There's activity. And yes, some of it is paging or swapping, but some of it is also just normal app activity. Getting information from the internet, updating config files, save files, temp files, and stuff like that. So please stop fear-mongering about SSD lifespan. Stop fear-mongering about, oh my god, you're using so much page file or swap file or partition. Oh my god, you need to upgrade. No, you really don't. As long as your system is running in a way you are satisfied with, you don't need more RAM. As long as you can do the work you want to do in a satisfying way, you don't need more RAM. It's only when you can't do the things you want to do, you need more RAM. That's how most people in IT upgrade. You don't go up to your boss and say, well, you need more RAM or CPU or hard disk because, well, I think you need it. Or, well, you may need it in 5 or 10 years or 2 or 3 years. Or, well, yeah, they could do their work like 1 or 2% faster. No, most bosses will only write a fucking clearance check for upgrades when there is an issue or close to being an issue. So please get your heads out of this RAM hell. I'm so fed up with all of the, so to speak, smart people on the internet that barely can fucking dig a hole without having someone doing it for them because they don't know how to hold a shovel in their fucking hands. If you are going to debate something, at least look into what the fuck you are talking about, okay? Yes, I'm a little bit angry about this because I've been yelled and screamed at for over 2 years now because I still recommend 8 gig for most people or casual users. Now you know why. This is how macOS does it, and it's not that different from how Windows and Linux does it. It's really not that different. What is different is the unified memory and non-unified memory, aka the CPU or the system on chip in Apple's case has faster and more efficient access to the memory than you have on your x86 system, meaning it can utilize less memory more efficiently than it can access, than your x86 machine can. And that will help it to some degree. I'm not saying that 8 gigabyte on Apple is the exact same as 16 gig on your system, but it's more efficient. So 8 gig may be more efficient on unified memory, or to some degree is, depending on the workload, than having 16 gig on your x86 system. Because on your motherboard, if you look at your CPU right now, there is a lot of space between your RAM. They're their own little thing, and you can upgrade, which is amazing, and I hate you can't upgrade it on Mac, and stuff like that. But with that comes latency, inefficiency, and stuff like that. There's a reason why your RAM is so close to your CPU on your motherboard, and they're not, you know, put down on the back end or lower end of the motherboard. I will go to get off my soapbox and do some adulting. See you all later. Bye-bye.